What is going on, guys? Welcome back to another Swift tutorial. In today's video, we're going to be looking at generics. So I'm going to preface this video that generics are a little tricky. So if you're an absolute beginner, you can definitely follow along, but I'd maybe suggest starting with my beginner's playlist. The other thing I want to call out is if you're not familiar with iOS Academy already, I'm putting together this website where I'm going to have all my courses, free and premium, some discussion forums, all that good stuff for all of us iOS fanatics to come and interact here. I think we seriously need to put together a pretty cool community for all of us to discuss things. So that said, if you haven't hit that like button already, my first 10-second rant, make sure to do so for that YouTube algorithm. So what we're going to start by doing is we're going to create a playground and we're going to look at generics in a playground. And then I'm also going to create a application, a project, and show more of a real world application of generics. Just so you guys can see the practicality of it. I think it's important to understand that. So that said, let's whip up Xcode and get started with a playground. So what the heck is a generic? So a generic, by definition, it's something that describes a genericized object. Hence, it's called a generic. So what does that mean? So the first thing you need to be familiar with is a protocol. So let's say we have a protocol of BMW, and let's say we also have a protocol of, let's actually change this to drivable, and let's call this one stoppable. And let's say we had a function, and this function basically returned an object, or return object, and we want to return an object that is both drivable or stoppable. So one way you could do this is you could actually type alias, let's make it object, and you can say this is drivable if autocomplete decides to cooperate. And you can say that object is also stoppable. And what you can do in here is you can return this, right? So notice that both of these are protocols and this is just wrapping both of them into one type. So this is totally correct. Now, this describes an abstract object and not a concrete object. So what we could also do is use a generic to achieve this. So let's say we got rid of that. Basically, to represent a generic, you use the token letter T, and you describe where T is drivable. Let's just copy and paste it because autocomplete is deciding to not be helpful as per usual. So where T is drivable and where T is stoppable. And we are basically going to return T. So what we can now do is we can say return, we can call this object or this function, return object, And you can see that it will return something that is both drivable and stoppable. And the T basically describes, so we basically typed aliases, if we really want to get technical, to T. But what we can now do is we can also use this T as a parameter. So we could say something along the lines of create something that is drivable and stoppable and use T as the parameter argument where T is drivable and stoppable. And let's say we had a class here called, let's do BMW. And we can say this is drivable and stoppable. Then what we could do here is we could say create car BMW. So generics have a cool level of looseness where you can really use it to create powerful functions that can be reused in a type safe way. So that last part of what I just said, a type safe way, is really the key here. For those of you that are familiar with Objective-C or some language that is not type safe, you can cast your objects kind of willy-nilly is kind of the best way I can really say it, is there's no type safety. And it gives you a good level of looseness where you can say you can pass in any object. However, it also leads to crashes, bugs, nil crashes, lots of issues. So this is a type safe way to represent generic object definitions. They could be protocols, they could be associated types, which I won't get into here, but this is a very, very kind of quick overview crash course of what the heck a generic is. Now, the best way I think to exemplify this is by looking at a real project. So I'm gonna close up that playground and we're gonna create a project. And I'm gonna show you a way that you can basically use a generic, and this is a way that I've used it myself personally in some of my personal projects. And it saves you a decent amount of code and is very practical. So in a lot of apps, we need to often accomplish the common task of going and fetching data from our API. And then from that data that we get back, we use the codable protocol on some struct that we have to convert the bytes to our, rather the JSON to our object. So if you're not familiar with codable, I'll quickly go over it in a few seconds. So don't worry about that. But basically we would have another object, and I like to call it something pretty straightforward like API caller. And I like to add a static instance property of it. So we can do shared as an API caller. And let's create a codable object. So let's say we're getting some data back and the data represents, the data represents a fruit, right? And fruit is codable. And basically a fruit, let's say, has a name, that'll be a string. It'll have an identifier, which will also be a string. It'll have a image name. And this is just like some properties that I'm making up. But basically this would match whatever JSON is being returned. Codable allows you, this protocol, to use a JSON decoder to take the bytes for the JSON and convert it to this native struct, this native object. But now a common problem that people run into is in an app, you don't just have one API call. You might have a ton of API calls. So you might have something like you have fruit there, and then you might also have an API call that returns a car. I don't know why you would in a fruit app, but you would have a car. Let's say you have another object for recipes, right? And these are recipes that you can create with the fruit. Just to exemplify that there are different properties in these structs. And my point is that you can imagine that the code we need to write to actually, let's see, why is this complaining? The code that we need to type to actually decode this is going to become redundant. And what it'll often look like is something like this. Let's say we have a public func in here to get fruits, right? And then in here, we're gonna have a URL session, shared data task with URL. Let's see, which one do we want? Data task with URL. We would create a URL in here. Let's pretend this is a real URL. You would have data response, which we don't care about, error. And then we would unwrap the data, validate an error is nil. Otherwise we'll return. Otherwise we could basically, what are we getting? Fruits. We would have fruit would be a fruit. And then to actually decode the bytes to JSON, we would do a do catch. And so fruit, this is a fruit. Just hit command B to make sure this is all compiling. Looks like we have an error somewhere. This should be do, not DC. And what we would do is we would do something along the lines of fruit equals try to use the JSON decoder to decode to fruit.self from the data. If it fails, we would maybe print out the error. And let's see, let me go ahead and hit command B, make sure this is compiling. Looks like we have an error here. What is it complaining about? This is an optional, so let's just force unwrap it. But basically we would do something like this, and it's just complaining that we haven't used this element yet. Let's make it a let. Here we can say nil. But basically, every single time we would create an API call, we would have to basically redundantly copy and paste this function and do this JSON decoding thing for each object type, right? So if we had like a get cars, we would have to have a car, and this would be a car, and this would be a car, and this, and more importantly, the type here would be a car. So you can quickly see why this isn't really pretty. So let's take a look at a way where we can actually write this function in a generic way to allow any type of API call to be made to any URL, as well as decode it to a given type that we pass in. So that way we can use one function as a one size fits all. So we're gonna change this function to be perform, let's call it API call. It's gonna have a generic T, where T is codable. And we're gonna say perform API call, URL will be a string, expecting return type will be T.type, and completion handler, let's say we return that type back, will be an escaping result. So let me close this right panel, will be an escaping result, where if successful, we return T, otherwise an error, and this whole thing is going to be returning void for the closure. Now you see that we introduced T here, and let me make sure the syntax looks good. T.type and escaping, we're gonna return an instance of T. So we've basically said that we have a generic parameter so long as a parameter is codable. And what we could do here is, let's first actually fix up our URL session task. That's how we actually kick it off. Now in here, what we can do is for every single API call, we of course want to fetch and get the contents of the URL. So this part doesn't need to change. What needs to change is a bit down here. So we're gonna say let fruit is T optional, because we don't wanna constrain this to a given type, and we're gonna change this to results. Let's call it decoded results. And we can get rid of that. Now here, what we can say is instead of decoding fruit.self, we're gonna decode t.self. And t is some object that conforms to codable. And then finally, if we've succeeded, we can, in the completion handler, in the success case, if you take a look at the signature of it actually over here, it expects success to be decodable and encodable. So where the heck is a compiler getting this from? Decodable and encodable is basically what makes up codable. Codable is a type alias over the other two types. But the reason it knows this is because we've said that T is codable, and T should be what we return in the result for the success type. So it's the only constraint to T is that it is compliant to codability. I feel like I just said codable like 30 times. But now we can pass in this decoded result, if I'm not mistaken. So this is T optional actually. So what we should do is we should unwrap it first. Let's go ahead and do that. We can actually get rid of this, and we can say guard let results equals this. Otherwise, we are going to return, and we should call failure case here. I'm just not going to do it for the purposes of this video because it's not really relevant. But we can now pass back the results. So this function now can be used for all of our API calls. And the really nice thing about this is, let's say I want to get cars, right? So I can do API caller shared, and I want to perform an API call. And the URL I'm going to perform it to is, let's say, we're just going to make up URLs, api.service.com/getcars. And the type we're expecting is car.self. And the completion is going to, let me actually just leave this on one line so the indentation doesn't get weird. The completion is going to be result in. Now what's really cool is the compiler is smart enough to, you know, infer all the types and such. So if we look at the success case, we should switch on results and we look at the success case. Come on, I really can't type today. The success case, you can see that even in here, it already knows that it's gonna return a car. But we never actually said in here that the return type in here is a car, the return type is T. But we've said as a parameter argument that T is going to be car. So we can actually say car, and let's say we wanna actually print out values of the car, we can use the car right away here. So let's say we add another property just to disambiguate the fruit and the car. In here, we can now say something along the lines of print car.carModel. And of course, in the failure case, we'll have an error that we'll just print out for now. Now, just to show that this works in a generic way, if I copy and paste this whole thing, and let's say we're expecting, and let me actually go ahead and delete this so you guys can see the difference again. And let's say we're getting fruits this time. You can say that the expected type is fruit.self. And once again, we get a result. But now if we try to switch on the result, you'll see in the success case, the compiler already knows that we're gonna get a fruit back. So basically we've genericized the decodability from T, and the way we pass it in is we just tell the function, here's what I want. And we also use T in the return result object, which is declared right here. And yeah, it adds a great amount of flexibility. So now in the success, we would get a fruit back. And let's just ignore the error for now. And what we can do in here is we can print out, say, fruit.name, and we're getting it directly off of the object. So all of this is type safe. It's pretty easy to read once you just know what the T does. You can now imagine that generics can get super complex when you start, you know, using a bunch of protocols to constrain the generic. It's a good practice to use generics where appropriate, but also sometimes people get carried away with them because they find them and they think they're really cool. So the one thing I'll caution about is don't use a generic as your first choice when you have a problem you encounter. Rather think about the actual things that you need to accomplish of what you're writing, whether it's a function or a class or some type of protocol injection. And really, really ask yourself, do I need a way to generically represent this? And if it's, you know, if you only have two use cases across your whole application that are going to use it, maybe you can use the more clean solution. Generics add complexity to projects. And as cool as they may be, and as much as you guys all should understand them, we want to avoid complexity, right? We just want to make the greatest app that we can with the minimum amount of code with the most efficiency and nicest UI. So that all said, I'm not gonna lecture you guys anymore on that. So those are generics. If you guys like the video, make sure you smash that like button down below for the YouTube algorithm. If you're new to the channel, welcome. If you enjoyed the video, hit that subscribe button while you're at it. Throw a comment down below if you have any questions, comments, concerns. And yeah, thanks for watching. I'll catch you guys in the next video.